So it says, Israelitish descendants, or the inhabitants occupying the central portion of Africa, passed forward seeking shelter to the south and west. A part, namely those from the east central crossing of the Bainu or Jolaba branch of the Niger, descended gradually southward and became intermingled with the original inhabitants. Protected from incursion on the north by the Bainu River and quietly settled between the Great Niger and Old Calabar Rivers, they remained in peace and grew from one generation to another in idolatry. We saw this in the Bible. When Israel was not punished, they fell back into idolatry, which goes back to why when you have the Kingdom of Judah in West Africa, we see them worshiping snakes. They fell into idolatry. But let's keep going. But still leaving tangible proofs in the form of their religion of the Judaistic origin of the inhabitants. After this slight digression, we will now proceed to investigate more particulars relative to the tribes under consideration. The language, or the little of it that is known, is full of Hebraisms. Cambridge goes over that too. If you guys read Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, it goes further into linguistics. The constructions of sentences, the verbal significations, the mode of comparison are all typical of the Hebrew. Like the Hebrew, from a single root of verbs and other elementary parts of speech, substantives, adjectives, and adverbs are formed. And the declination of nouns, the Reverend J. F. Sean, linguist to the Church Missionary Society, whilst writing of the cases said, there are none in the sense they appear in Latin, and consequently there are no declinations. But there are cases in the sense in which it is applied in the Hebrew language, namely that form of nouns to which are appended or suffixed the attributive or possessive pronoun. Well might a writer in the African times, when writing on the subject of black, the original color of the white race, finish his article with the following addenda. Pay close attention if you've never heard this before. The Isthmus of Suez plays an important part in the history of Africa and the Ethiopian race. Ancient mythology has proved that through it, extensive migratory movement took place several thousand years ago from Asia Minor to Africa. From a little study of the ethnology of the language of West African and the Hebrew tongue, one is involuntarily brought to trace out a similarity, and one of them to that of the tribes which, from disobedience to the will of God, were dispersed, and the greatest number of them possibly went to Africa. He's talking about the lost tribes of Israel. He's going to clarify. I mean the lost tribes of Israel. So now, they're saying that the lost tribes of Israel went to Africa here. Parfit is quoting from people saying that they thought the tribes of Israel were in Central Africa. They had notes written in Hebrew in case they ran into Jews in Africa. And you have Christians today telling you they see no proof of this. They don't know what's going on. They can't find any sources. There was no Jews in West Africa. This is what they told us in the beginning. Then they told us they were white Jews. Now the sources say, no, these were Portuguese Jews. The Portuguese Jews are black. They mix with the native black population. They have black children all down the west coast of Africa, all in the interior of Africa. And yet nobody know nothing about these Jews. We don't know who they are. We don't know where they went to. All we know is they was hitchhiking on slave ships with the same Portuguese that were persecuting them in the Inquisition. They buddy-buddy now, and they just giving them, I don't know, medieval Uber across the ocean. They just booking ships like they book Ubers. Just take me across the ocean. I know y'all persecuting us. Just, I want to hitchhike across this ocean. This is the narrative that they've given us over the years. So, let me... All right, the lost tribe says, if the rites and ceremonies of the religion of the tribes bordering on the banks of the river Niger be closely examined and compared with the original religion of the Hebrews at the earliest period, viz. Eber tribe, if the Ebo language with all its corruptions be compared with that of the Hebrews, and if the peculiar disposition of the Hebrew tribes as detailed in scripture and that of the Ebos be properly investigated, that's the key, properly investigated, there will be a priori of reasons for a serious inquiry whether the Ebo tribe, which is but a branch of the Gala tribe in the interior, is the offspring of the lost tribes of Israel, driven down from Central Africa and forced to cross the Eastern and Bainu branch of the Niger by Mohammedan fanaticism. Now, they suspected that the Igbo were Israelites. We're not going to go over all that evidence right now. I've gone over it before in multiple videos. The memorandum to the president that calls the Igbo the wandering Jews of West Africa. We've talked about the Obadiah Alliance in 2022, declaring Igbo to be descendants of ancient Israelites. I have multiple sources spanning multiple centuries about the Igbo. We have John Ogilvie in the 1600s saying that there were Jews living along the Niger River. Tudor Parfitt just mentioned Ogilvie. So all this stuff is connected when you start to, you know, look at history and see that it's consistent if you're not trying to lie. I'm not going to read all this, but it's a lot of good information here. You guys should check it out. Now, one more time, I do want to show this map right here. We're still talking about this is the Gold Coast, as we heard about earlier. This is the Slave Coast. So you're going to have Ghana, Benin, Togo, and Nigeria all encompassed in these areas right here. This is Guinea. Negroland, this is Upper Guinea, and you're gonna have Southern or Lower Guinea down this way, going down into Angola. So this is the area we're talking about. And remember, the Kingdom of Judah is known as the Slave Coast. Hannah Adams said this is the Kingdom of Judah. This is Judah, Benjamin, and Levi. And then we had the other source that said Judah, Benjamin, Levi, and Simeon were sent into Spain as migrants, not slaves, by Nebuchadnezzar. And now we know they're forced down here. So let's keep reading. Tudor Parfitt says, perhaps a further glimpse of sorts may be offered from a source describing new Christians and the Capuchins' struggle against the elitist black secret order called the Kempasi. Even further south in Angola, the Kempasi used a cross-like sign in their rituals. Girolamo was a GM. Capuchin missionary to the Congo between 1648 and 1668 observed in puzzlement that the members of the Kempasi Society had at the entrance of their meeting place a great portico or entrance with a sacred sign of a cross painted in diverse colors. M's colleague and contemporary Giovanni Cavazzi also observed the cross and noted the devil had taught the Kempasi initiates that to entice new Christians, they should paint on their idols the venerable sign of the cross so as to hide their pernicious sentiments and their sacrilegious impiety. One would not believe, he admitted, how many people were seduced by this ruse. In this, an indication of anusim, in the spiritual dislocation of having been forced to give up one religion in favor of another. Anusim are people who are Jews who were forced to convert to other religions, and through acculturation groping in the alienating circumstances of West Africa towards a religious manifestation which was familiar, the cross, yet thoroughly African. So basically he's saying that the secret black secret society had adopted the cross. The devil taught them to use the cross to lure new Christians, Jews who had converted to Catholicism. The descendants of these Jews and other Portuguese immigrants, or I'm guessing that's immigrants, of Cape Verde Islanders and of West Africans developed a culture that was itself a synthesis of African and European elements. Now, don't confuse that word European with meaning white automatically, because there were black Europeans just like there are white Africans now in modern history. I know someone, went to school with someone. I tell people all the time. He's a friend of mine. He's on my Facebook. I'm not going to give his name out because the last time I did, people started hitting him up. But a friend of mine who is white that I went to school with, he is an African-American, and it says it on his license, and it has always said it on his ID that he is African-American. He was born and raised in South Africa, and in high school, or right before he started high school, they came to the U.S. He was the first person I literally met from Africa that I knew in a one-on-one basis. I knew of some black guys from Africa, but we weren't like friends like that. But I had PE with this guy, and we had some mutual friends, so I hung out with him all the time. But he is an African-American because he was born in Africa and Then he migrated and became a U.S. citizen. So he is an African American. So, yeah, you can have black Europeans. You can have white Africans. Don't confuse where someone is born with the lineage that they are from. And I find that is a huge problem in our community. When people say African, they act like that is a lineage. Africa is an entire continent. It doesn't matter what it used to be called or was never named Africa. That's irrelevant. The fact is, right now, we call it Africa. And when you are born on that continent, you are African. Just like if you were born in South America, you're considered South American, North American. It's based on where you're born. Then you have lineage. Who did you descend from? What people did you descend from? So you can have an Israelite who was born in Arabia, and he would be an Arabian Israelite. And if you have one that is born and raised in Africa, he would be an African Israelite. But it doesn't mean that they are descended from Hamites. And a lot of people confuse those two things. They say, okay, well, you're here in this location, so that must mean you are sub-Saharan African. No. Remember, the Portuguese Jews are put in West Africa. They're not sub-Saharan African. But they're in West Africa, and they're black just like the sub-Saharan Africans. So you have to kind of use common sense when you read through history, and you have to have a good grasp on what history is going on. A lot of people who just got into this want to play expert when they haven't even done the work yet, and they think they know more about history than they do. I'll read it one more time. The descendants of these Jews and other Portuguese immigrants, of Cape Verde Islanders and of West Africans, developed a culture that was itself a synthesis of African and European elements, which was despised by the Portuguese. The Jewish element of this mixed population, which in some places remained a discrete and visible element, seems in others possibly to have been absorbed by the host society. There are then numerous references after the 17th century to black Jews in various places in West Africa. Numerous references, according to Parfit, and yet you listen to some of these Christians tell you they can't find the evidence. Somebody's lying. Either all these people are lying about what happened and Jews being in Africa, or it's the Christians that are lying to everybody. Remember, Satan deceived the whole world. If the Christians aren't telling you the truth, there's a reason for it. I would encourage you to start asking Christians about this history and see if they lie to you or not. And if they're lying to you about the history, it's one thing to say, I don't know because I never studied it. Okay, cool. That's acceptable. But if they start outright lying to you about history, saying things didn't happen that did happen, or things did happen that didn't happen, or any of these combinations of things, ask yourself, why is this person sitting up here lying to me about this history? What agenda do they have to lie? There are then numerous references after the 17th century to black Jews in various places in West Africa. One of these communities, while being little known or not known at all today, even by specialists in the field of African Judaic studies, was to exercise a profound fascination on Western thinkers and travelers for hundreds of years. This strangely unremarked group was influential not so much for what we know about it, because in truth we know very little about it, but for what it represented for Western thinkers for a very considerable time, and what it continued to signify in Europe until present times. There is evidence that there were black Jews along the coast of what is today the Republic of Congo, perhaps of Iberian or Spain and Portuguese origin, concentrated on the Vili kingdom of Luango between the equator and the mouth of the Congo. All right, so this is the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and right next to it here is Congo. So you have Congo and the Democratic Republic of the Congo. All right, so now you have an idea. They're generally talking about this area right here, this white or this whatever color this is, this peached out area, and this darker orangish area right here. All right, so let's see here. The Kingdom of Luango was a powerful, trading centralized pre-colonial African state which survived until the 19th century or the 1800s. The Kingdom of Luango had a number of well-constructed towns, including the important wall trading town of Luango itself. The Malongo, Luango's ruler, played the competing trading nations, specifically the Portuguese and Dutch, against each other, and Vili middlemen operated as brokers between the local traders and European ship captains. This led to great fortunes being made, much of which was in the hands of African nobles. Now, here's where we get to some lesser known pieces of history. As we have seen, there was a sense in medieval Europe. So if we jump over here real quick, the medieval era, often called the Middle Ages or Dark Ages, began around 476 AD, following the great loss of power throughout Europe by the Roman Emperor. The Middle Ages span roughly 1,000 years, ending between 1400 and 1450. So we're talking about a roughly 1,000-year period from 476 to roughly 450 AD. It's considered the Middle Ages. So when you see this term, Middle Ages, this is that 1,000-year period where people had certain beliefs. All right, so now that you understand that the Middle Ages lasts roughly between 476 and 1450 AD, this will make more sense in context. As we have seen, there was a sense in medieval Europe that the interior of Africa, the interior of Africa was peopled in part by Jews in the form of the lost tribes of Israel. And this was particularly the case in the West African hinterland, or this is the area behind the coast, the coastland, basically. So one more time, as we have seen, there was a sense in medieval Europe that the interior of Africa was peopled in part by Jews in the form of the lost tribes of Israel, and this was particularly the case in the West African hinterland or coastland. So how is it that in the 400s, before 75 AD and 1450 AD, people believed that the Jews were in Africa? And now in 2024 AD, when we start to say that they were in Africa, people tell us there was no evidence. People tell us these were white Jews. People tell us they were hitchhiking on slave ships. People were telling us they were never on the slave ships to begin with. They have changed their story and moved the goalposts so many times. If you guys run into this, those of you who have been around for a while know how much the goalpost has been moved since day one, and never have we ever received an apology from the Christians who were opposed to this information. Not one time have we heard the Christians say, you know what? We were wrong when we said there were no Jews in West Africa. We misled all the people listening to us. We haven't heard that. Then when they said the Jews were white, I'm not going to say the sister's name because she can't defend herself, but nobody came to her aid when she said the Jews were white. And then after they did her dirty and kicked her out from among these Christian apologists, they started saying the Jews in West Africa were white. And now we see sources that say the Portuguese Jews were black. Specifically, the Portuguese Jews were black. The irony of all this information. And yet we haven't heard them come forward and say, you know what? We were wrong about these white Jews in Africa. This wasn't true. We misled you all historically. We haven't heard the Christians be humble enough to say that. And now the Christians have employed the help of an atheist that wants to convince us that not only does Judah, the kingdom of Judah, have nothing to do with the Judah of the Bible because it doesn't have an H, even though New Testament spells it without an H. So it must be the New Testament has nothing to do with the Judah of the Bible either. But his argument was it couldn't be Judah because it don't have an H. Widow means bird. These people must be descended from birds. Oh, wait, they don't have nothing to do with the Jews that were put down there, even though Hannah Adams and other sources say that these were the southern kingdom, the tribe of Judah, the kingdom of Judah. This has nothing to do with that. And they weren't on slave ship. They were hitchhiking. This is what they find to be intelligent. And some of y'all know exactly what channel I'm talking about. This right here is their most intelligent argument that they put forward, that these Jews were hitchhiking on slave ships. I'm gonna keep bringing that up because it's ridiculous. We all know it's ridiculous, but the more I say it, the more ridiculous it sounds. And I'm gonna keep saying it just so y'all understand how ignorant is the person is saying, you can understand how ignorant they are. And they keep bringing them back on and they keep eating this stuff up because you have the blind leading the blind. When you have a person who runs a channel that's not really intelligent in the first place, or less intelligent than he pretends to be, he will let stupid people come on and say stupid stuff to a stupid audience who eat this stupid stuff up.